one here. Is it a draft coming in from somewhere?
Oh. Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Jaya Gopi Jana Vallabha Girivara Dhari. Jaya Gopi Jana Vallabha Girivara Dhari. Yashoda Nandana Vraja Jana Ranjana. Yashoda Nandana Vraja Jana Ranjana. Yamuna Tira Vanachari. Yamuna Tira Vanachari. Jaya Radha Madhava Kunja Bihari. Jaya Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Shri Vasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
Krishna,
Jai Jai Prabhupad, 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 Jaya Jaya Prabhupad. Jai Om Vishnupad Paramhansa Parivrajakacharya Ashtotra Satrahistivayan Grace Abhay Charanaravinda Bhakti Vedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai Ananta Koti Vaishnava Vrinda Ki Jai Granthraj Srimad Bhagavatam Ki Jai Nitai Gaur Premanande. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories to the assembled devotees. All glories, all glories, all glories to Sri Guru and Gauranga. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Narayanam Namaskritya. Naram Chaiva Narottamam. Devim Sarasvatim Vyasam. Tato jayamudirayet nashta prayeshva bhadreshu nityam bhagavata sevaya bhagavatyuttama shloke bhaktir bhavati nashthiki. Reading from Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 10, Chapter 51, The Deliverance of Muchukunda, Texts 10, 11, and 12. Right? Sorry? Yeah, 12 has a purport, so I think we should do up to 12, yes? So which is up on the board?
19.
Okay, so we'll just go up to 12 and we can avoid the repetitive thing because there's a long purport here. Sorry? In 12, yeah. So I'll read the translations for 10 and 11. So after leading me such a long distance, now he is lying here like some saint, thus thinking the sleeping man to be Lord Krishna. The deluded fool kicked him with all his strength. 11. The man awoke after a long sleep and slowly opened his eyes. Looking all about, he saw Kala Yavana standing beside him. 12. Satavatasya rushtasya drishti pate na bharata dehe jena agnina dagdho bhasmasada bhavat kshanat. Translation. The awakened man was angry and cast his glance at Kala Yavana, whose body burst into flames. In a single moment, O King Parikshit, Kala Yavana was burnt to ashes. Purport. The man who incinerated Kala Yavana with his glance was named Muchukunda. As he will explain to Lord Krishna, he had fought for a long time on behalf of the demigods. Finally, taking as his benediction the right to sleep undisturbed. The Hari Vamsha explains that he secured the further benediction of being able to destroy anyone who disturbed his sleep. Acharya Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur quotes from the Sri Hari Vamsha as follows. Prasuptam bodhayedyo mam tam daheyam aham suraha chakshusha krodha deeptena evam aha punah punah. Again and again Muchukunda said, O demigods, with eyes blazing with anger, may I incinerate anyone who awakens me from sleep. Srila Vishwanath Chakravarti explains that Muchukunda made this rather morbid request to scare Lord Indra, who Muchukunda thought might otherwise wake him repeatedly to request his help in fighting Indra's cosmic enemies. Indra's consent to Muchukunda's request is described in Sri Vishnu Puran as follows. Proktascha devai samsuptam yastvam utthapayishyati deha jenagnina sadyah satu bhasmi karishyati. The demigods declared, whoever awakens you from sleep will suddenly be burnt to ashes by a fire generated from his own body. Om Jnana Timirandhasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurun Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha Shri Chaitanya Mano Bhishtam Sthapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kada Mahyam Dadati Svapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Yutapadakamalam Shri Gurun Vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunathanvitam Tam Sajivam Sadvaitam Savadhutam Parijana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padam Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakhanvitamscha Nama Om Vishnu Padaya Krishna Preshthaya Bhutale Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swamin Niti Namine Namaste Saraswate Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Shunyavadi Paschatya Deshatarine Vancha Kalpatarubhyascha Kripa Sindhubhya Evacha Patitanam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Shivasadi Gaur Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna. So rather interesting pastime, this. First of all, Lord Krishna has run away from the battlefield. And he has, out of his sense of deep renunciation or detachment, not bothered himself with the prospect of people criticizing him in future for this act that is ordinarily considered quite disgraceful for the Kshatriyas. Krishna not only walks away, he actually runs away. And sure enough, the insults come immediately, not just in future, because Kali Yavana begins taunting him and insulting him, and Krishna remains very calm even when he is thus insulted. Insult and praise are two sides of the same coin in the material world. The dualities of this material world means that we are sometimes praised and sometimes blamed or insulted. We are sometimes happy and sometimes distressed. We are sometimes honored and sometimes dishonored. And that is the way of this world. One who is within the jurisdiction of the three modes of material nature, under the clutches of the illusory potency of the Lord, Maya, is severely afflicted by these opposites. When somebody is praised, he becomes very happy. And when the same person is insulted, he becomes very sorry or very depressed. And in the Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna explains that a person who is absorbing his consciousness in the Absolute Truth will be able to transcend these dualities and come to the platform of being equipoised in the midst of these dualities, which means one will treat happiness and distress alike. One will treat honor and dishonor alike. One will treat fame and infamy alike. One will also treat praise and blame or insult alike. And that is because one has become absorbed in the Absolute Truth. Tatha mana apamana yoho. Mana means respect, apaman means disrespect or insult. So an ordinary human being, by absorbing his or her mind in the Absolute Truth, can rise beyond the dualities and treat praise and insult equally. How is it then possible that the Absolute Truth Himself would be subject to these dualities? It stands to reason, therefore, that the Absolute Truth is always transcendentally situated and is never afflicted by these dualities of the material world, very simply because even by meditating upon Him, human beings can transcend these dualities. So Krishna is not at all concerned about how He may be praised or blamed in this world. When we offer words of praise to Krishna, it's not that Krishna feels so pleased. And it's also equally not that when we insult Krishna, Krishna feels terrible about it. He is completely aloof from our words of praise or blame for Him. So this is something that is a matter of understanding, because we are trying to be Krishna conscious. So being Krishna conscious means that we must be conscious of the different qualities of Krishna and His status as the Supreme Personality of Godhead. It is we who need to praise Krishna for our benefit. It is we who need to avoid blaspheming Krishna and the devotees of Krishna for our benefit. Krishna doesn't need our praise, and He's not affected by our insult either. But we need to perfect our life by glorifying Krishna. The acts of praising and glorifying Krishna are indeed what will make our life perfect, successful, and happy. We see in the Srimad Bhagavatam and also the other scriptures like the Mahabharata, many demoniac people insulted Krishna on many occasions. But Krishna was quite aloof from the whole thing. And sometimes He would act as a human, and then He would respond as a Kshatriya should respond when he's taunted in battle and mocked in battle. So He would do that. One time the king called Pondrak sent a message threatening Krishna with dire consequences if he continued to declare himself as Vasudev. And he said, Pondrak said, I am the real Vasudev. And right in the assembly, Krishna laughed heartily. And that's what Shukadev Goswami describes. He had a hearty laugh about the whole matter. And then when he went out into the battlefield, he saw Pondrak there with two false extra arms, because he wanted to show that actually he is a real Vasudev. And he had the Kaustubh jewel and everything else. So Krishna doesn't take these things seriously. Sometimes, however, for the benefit of the person who is insulting, he may take some action, like he did in the case of Shishupal. Shishupal was his cousin, the son of the king of Chedi. And right from his very birth, Shishupal was envious of Krishna. It is said in the Mahabharata that when Shishupal was born, he wasn't born crying like an ordinary human baby. When a human baby comes out of the womb of the mother, the baby cries. But this child was very peculiar, because when he emerged from his mother's womb, he was braying, not crying. Braying like a donkey. And everybody understood that this was a very inauspicious sign. That when a child comes out braying, you know, that's something quite unusual. And then naturally the parents were very worried. And then he had this, you know, extra limbs on his body, he had these extra eyes, and he has all kinds of things, extra arms and whatnot. And then an astrologer predicted that yes, these extra limbs will fall off when the person who is destined to kill him will hold him in his arms. So then the parents were really anxious what to do. So everyone who would visit, they would place the child in the arms to see whether the extra limbs would fall off, the eyes and so on. And for everyone, they held the child and then nothing happened. But Krishna came. Krishna was also young at that time. And when he held the child, then these extra things dropped off. And then Shishupal's mother understood that Krishna would be the cause of Shishupal's death in the future. And she made Krishna promise, please protect my son. He said, okay, I will not harm your son, but there's a limit. Till he abuses me or insults me 100 times consecutively, I'll not do anything to him. But the moment he crosses that mark, then I will have to do the needful. So Shishupal was always cautious to not cross the number. But he was actually constantly insulting Krishna. You know, from his very childhood, from the time that he could learn to speak, he was insulting Krishna. You know, we see that children, when they start speaking, they learn how to talk. They may learn things like mama, papa, whatever it is that they learn, you see, car, food, they will have little words. But for Shishupal, the first word he started learning was how to insult Krishna. From his very babyhood and childhood, ever since he was able to think, he was insulting Krishna. So his heart was full of envy. He never lost an opportunity to insult Krishna. But Krishna remained detached always. And at the Rajasuya Yajna, the great sacrifice performed by King Yudhishthir at the instructions of Krishna, all the great kings of the world and the sages and eminent people were invited. And the time came to appoint somebody to receive the first worship, which is called the Agra Puja. At the commencement of a sacrifice like this, it was customary to select some respectable person, actually the most respectable person amongst the assembled persons, and then offer him special worship, and then commence the rituals. So when the idea came up that Krishna should be appointed for that Agra Puja, many, many others, including Sahadev, heartily seconded this proposal. But Shishupal became angry like fire, and he began spewing venom, and he began insulting Krishna in very harsh words. He went on and on and on, and he was saying things like, and those were the mildest among them, he said things like this: Krishna, what can we say about him? You can't even know what is his varna. You know, in Vrindavan he was herding cows, he was a Vaishya, and now here he's play acting as a prince, which is a Kshatriya. Is he a Vaishya? Is he a Kshatriya? What is he? This person is of indeterminate varna. You know, Therefore, what kind of Agra Puja should we offer him? And so on and so on. So he went on and on and on. And everybody was livid with rage, especially the Pandavas. And Bhima was there gnashing his teeth. But Krishna just calmed him down. And everybody understood that Krishna was biding his time. And Shishupal was unstoppable. He couldn't hold himself back. You see, when somebody gets possessed by negative energies or negative attributes like lust, greed, anger, envy, it's unstoppable. You can't stop such a person. These forces and the negative forces can be very powerful. So Shishupal couldn't stop himself, even though he saw impending death. And then finally, when Shishupal crossed the limit, then very quietly, Krishna just released his Sudarshan Chakra, his disc, and Shishupal's head was chopped off. And the soul from the body of Shishupal came out shining like a meteor in front of everybody. In everybody's sight, Shishupal's soul came and merged into Krishna's body. And everyone was really astonished to see this. And that, of course, sparked a question from Yudhishthira Maharaj to Narad Muni. How is it that this sinful, envious Shishupal, who was constantly insulting Krishna, could obtain the liberation of Sayujya, even though that Sayujya Mukti, or the liberation of merging into the Lord and his impersonal effulgence, is something the devotees don't want, but nevertheless, it is a form of liberation. The yogis and the jnanis aspire for that, and it takes them many, many lifetimes to achieve that goal. And here we have this one person who was envious, sinful, arrogant. He had no spiritual qualities about him. He never performed any austerities. How is it that he got this liberation? You know, so this discussion was quoted by Shukadev Goswami to King Parikshit. And actually, that's an important part of the discussion that goes on then in the Srimad Bhagavatam, but we won't go into that. Suffice it to say that Krishna was personally aloof. Even when Shishupal continued with his insults and abuses, Krishna could have peacefully sat down for another 1,000 abuses or 1,000,000 abuses. It didn't matter to Krishna. You see, it's just like a person, you know, there's a little proverb in India that says that if you look up at the sun and spit at the sun in anger, what happens? Falls in your own face again. You see, and if we criticize the sun and say, sun is like this and like that, is the sun affected by it? The sun is peacefully where it is. The sun is such a powerful being, such a powerful force. What difference does it make to the sun? If some insignificant human being is hurling abuses at the sun, it doesn't make any difference. Generally, you know, when you say you spit at something, which means you really want to say that this thing is despicable, you know. So if you look at the sun and want to spit at the sun, the only thing that really happens is that you get the spit back on your face. In other words, when we insult a great personality, what to speak of the greatest of all personalities, the Supreme Lord, that great person is not harmed. Rather, the person who tries to insult the great person is harmed. In return, this is the consequence. So Kala Yavana was insulting Krishna, and he had to get the just results of his act. So why then did Krishna not, you know, destroy him or kill him right away? As we were discussing yesterday or day before, Krishna wanted to keep intact the benediction that was, the vow of Gargya, that he would teach the Yadus a lesson, because the Yadus had laughed at him on one occasion. And so in the womb of the wife of the king of the Yavanas, he bore this child. And so this child was born, and he was a very demoniac person. At the same time, one of the purposes of Krishna's advent was that he wanted to reduce the burden of the demoniac people on this earth. And how does Krishna do this? Krishna doesn't so often personally kill with his own hands. He does it sometimes, like he did for Shishupal, but he doesn't always do that for the general mass of demoniac people. What he does is, he uses others as instruments. Just like he got the Pandavas and Kauravas to fight each other, and on either side were amassed the armies of the whole world. Because the earth was overburdened with the military forces of the world, who were causing a great disturbance to Mother Earth, so he had these two armies, the military forces, assembled on one battlefield, and then had them destroy each other. So Krishna acts like a hot breeze on a hot summer day in a forest that makes dry pieces of wood or branches or something rub against each other and then create a spark, and then that spark gets inflamed and becomes a conflagration, and then it just burns down the whole forest. So Krishna was that spark. He just sets the whole thing in motion because he wants to see the earth relieved of demoniac forces. So sometimes he may use his devotees as instruments to do that, and sometimes he may just get the demoniac people to fight with each other and do that. So whatever be the instrumentality of Krishna's actions, his purpose is like this, to relieve the earth. So Kali Yavana was also a burden on this earth. So Krishna fulfills many purposes with one action. So with this act of Krishna running away from the battlefield, Krishna not only demonstrated his quality of detachment and renunciation, he not only physically at the external level avoided another big war in which many of his dear devotees in Mathura would be affected, he also wanted to start his Dwarka pastimes now. He was now about 28 years of age. It was time now to move on, 18 years in Mathura, and he wanted to move on to Dwarka. He also wanted to deliver and show his mercy to his devotee Muchukunda, who was sleeping in the cave. And also he wanted to have Kala Yavana killed. So all these things were accomplished with this one action of Krishna's running away. So Kala Yavana was chasing him, but he couldn't reach him. And finally Krishna entered into a cave where the king Muchukunda lay asleep. And then Kala Yavana came in. He thought that the person lying inside the cave is Krishna. In great anger, he kicked the person who was lying down. But that person was King Muchukunda, who again was very upset when he was awoken like this. He opened his eyes, and Kala Yavana's body was burnt to ashes. And we read here in the purport as well that King Muchukunda was a great warrior. He was a devotee of the Lord, and he was very favorably disposed to other devotees like the demigods. Once when the demigods were in difficulty, they requested Muchukunda to come and fight on their behalf against the demons, and Muchukunda agreed. The fight went on for a long time. And of course, in that time, many, many years had passed on the earth. King Muchukunda, after the battle, now was extremely tired. He hadn't slept for years and years. So now that the demigods obtained their commander-in-chief, Skanda, they said, okay, King Muchukunda, now we relieve you of this work. Thank you very much for coming and helping us. So he said, yes, all right. Then the demigods asked him, what benediction would you like from us? And of all things that King Muchukunda could have asked for, he asked for a benediction that he should be allowed to sleep for a long time. Sometimes we also think like that. We want to sleep for a long time. And then the second part was that of the benediction he requested was, I should sleep undisturbed. That's also something we wish for, especially living here with all these sirens going off, wah, 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 all the time. Or if you're living in an ashram, there's people coming and going and talking loudly. So that was not the end of it. He had a third part to the benediction. That not only should I be undisturbed, but should anyone dare to disturb me? And if I wake up, then when I look at that person's body should burn to ashes. So the purport here says that why would Muchukunda make such a morbid request? The answer, of course, was that he had had enough of fighting. He had fought for a long, long time. So he wanted to ensure that Indra would not once again wake him up and say, come and fight again. He had done his duty amply. So then Krishna knew about this, of course. And so he brought the two together. So it was time for Muchukunda to wake up anyway. He wanted to give his mercy to Muchukunda, who was his devotee. And we'll see that wonderful passage in the verses to come, when Muchukunda will actually glorify Krishna in beautiful prayers and Krishna will bless him. So he wanted to wake up Muchukunda and deliver him. He also wanted to deliver Kali Yavana by having him killed by his devotee. So he arranged for it to come together. Krishna is the supreme arranger. He arranges everything. In the Bhagavad Gita, he says, Ishvara Sarva Bhutanam Riddeshi Arjuna Tishtati Brahmanyan Sarva Bhutanam Yantra Rudhani Mayaya. I am seated in the heart of all living entities and I direct the wanderings of everyone. So sometimes he does it, mostly he does it seated as a Paramatma or the Super Soul within the heart. And sometimes in his manifest pastimes, he actually externally does this service. So now as the Lord externally, he arranged the meeting of Muchukunda and Kali Yavana. And Kali Yavana thought Muchukunda was Krishna. He kicked him. Muchukunda woke up. His eyes blazed with anger. And then there was a fire that arose as a result of that in Kali Yavana's body, and his body burned to ashes. Sometimes I think many devotees wish they had that power, especially when they're woken in the morning for Mangalarati. You know, you're so fast asleep and someone comes and wakes you up and you're really angry. Why is someone destroying my sleep? I want to sleep. So, anyway, this power is not something extremely unusual. We find narrations of that in many other situations too. For example, when Lord Shiva was absorbed in deep meditation and he had so much power, the demigods led by Cupid, Kamadev, attempted to disrupt his meditation. And they sent these beautiful Apsara maidens from the heavenly planets to entice Lord Shiva and to stop his meditation. Shiva, of course, is Dhira. Dhira means one who's completely sober, completely in control of his senses. So Shiva understood what happened. And he was furious. And at that time he opened his third eye, which he generally doesn't open. which is on his forehead between the two eyes. And the third eye opened and blazed, and Kamadeva, Cupid, was burned to ashes. So, of course, there is a basic fire element within us. It's there even in the belly. Aham Vaishvanara Bhutva, Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, I am the fire of digestion. So the fire element is there even in the body. And by some external stimulus, it may be possible to ignite that to such a degree that the very body may get burnt. So Shiva destroyed Cupid like that. The yogis, they have the power to destroy their own bodies like this. When Dhritarashtra was in the forest, and we find this description in the Srimad Bhagavatam, when the time came for him to depart from this world, by his yogic power, he burnt his own body. Similarly, when the 60,000 sons of Sagar, King Sagar, in search of their horse for the Ashvamedha Yajna, approached Kapila Muni thinking wrongly that the sage had stolen the horse, the sage Kapila then opened his eyes, and just by the sound he incinerated the 60,000 sons. So the fire in their bodies became so strong it blazed and burned them to ashes. And finally it was the great-grandson Bhagirath who delivered them by bringing Mother Ganga down to the earth. So these things do happen. Here we see that Muchukunda has been used as an instrument by Krishna to accomplish Krishna's purpose, and the demon Kaliyavana was thus destroyed. But because he was destroyed by Krishna's arrangement and by Krishna's devotee, there is obviously something auspicious about it. To be killed by the personal arrangement of Krishna or by Krishna's devotee is definitely something that is not usual. It's a good fortune. So we'll stop here. Are there any questions or comments? Yes, Maharaj, any comments?
Army, surely he wanted to kill all the army too. Any information about that?
Sorry?
Any information how Kaliyavana's army was, because he wanted to kill all the demonic forces.
Right.
But he just killed Kaliyavana alone. So this seems a bit inconsistent. So any explanation, is there any explanation of that?
There doesn't seem to be any description of Krishna killing armies of Kali Yavana. But yes, as he went on further, then there is the story, of course, of how Krishna and Balaram, then they escape from there, they move away, and they jump off and then go on to Dwarka. That part is mentioned. So, but about Kali Yavana's army, that's not mentioned. But yes, Jarasandha pursues them, and that we're going to see in the next chapter. Because Krishna then, after killing Kaliyavana, having Kaliyavana killed, returns to Mathura. Because Balaram is there. Yes, then it is mentioned here that he destroyed the army of the barbarians and began taking their valuables to Dwarka. So he did. So he killed Kaliyavana in this way, and then he came back and killed Kaliyavana's army. And then he carried all the wealth back. He wanted to take it to Dwarka, and that's the time Jarasandha appeared with his army. And Krishna fled again. Krishna went away, didn't fight again. So Krishna and Balaram then went away, didn't fight with Jarasandha. That was a battle to be fought another day, and Krishna would be personally arranging Jarasandha's destruction through the hands of Bhima. that would come later. So yes, to answer the question, Krishna did personally go back and kill, destroy Kali Yavana's army also. Yeah, any other question? Okay.
Yes,
sir. Yes.
Thank you very much. Thank you for your class, Maharaj. You were saying earlier on that one shouldn't be attached to honor and dishonor. But isn't this kind of preaching movement, and isn't the reputation of the preachers very important for their preaching to be effective?
Yes, indeed, that's true. However, one desires this not for oneself, not for one's own, the gratification of one's ego. Because generally, we like honor and we dislike dishonor because it affects the ego, positively or negatively. So if we desire such a thing, it's not for one's ego, but it's for the reputation of the mission, for the good name of the Acharya, of Srila Prabhupada, of Krishna consciousness, and so on. Also for the sake of the good name of other devotees. And yet at the end of it, as far as we go personally, if that's what Krishna desires, then the devotee succumb, he says, all right, if that's what Krishna's desire, that he wishes me to be dishonored in this way, he accepts it as Krishna's arrangement. So there's both things there.
Thank you very much, James.
Hare Krishna. Yes. Can you give the mic, please?
Thank you, Maharaj. I want please to have confirmation on you mentioned in this shloka Ishvara Sarva Bhutanam Hridesharjana Tishtati that the Lord is arranging in the material world as Paramatma. Then there is another I heard that even Krishna himself, he participates in the arrangements of the devotee, not as in the form as Paramatma, but Krishna himself. And the shloka that would confirm that is from the Brahma Samhita, this Premanjana Churita Bhakti Vilochanena Santasa Deva Ridayeshavi Vakayat. That is Krishna Yam Shyama Sundara Chintya Guna Swarupam. That Krishna himself is in the heart if the person is devotee. Should we understand like that, or is it like speculation?
Well, there's no difference because the Paramatma is Krishna. He is just a different form of Krishna, that's all. He is just a four-handed form of Krishna, he is an expansion of Krishna, but he is Krishna.
So it's okay to understand that a devotee has this contact not with Paramatma but with Krishna in his heart?
No, there's no difference between Paramatma and Krishna. Paramatma is Krishna. Yes? So we are in touch with the Paramatma, the pure, you know, and only thing is we forget, we don't know that the Paramatma is constantly guiding us. So the pure devotee revives his contact with the Lord in the heart.
But Paramatma, we understand to be the weakness and the he permits the
yes.
weakness. But Krishna is totally different action. So something
yes,
changes there. No?
Yes, that is there in terms of the role that he may play. It's there. Krishna becomes a little more active for his devotee. Krishna personally intervenes in the life of his devotee. But Paramatma is also intervening. The Paramatma also arranges so many things for every living entity. He arranges the meeting of individuals, he arranges the happiness and distress, everything is arranged by the Paramatma, the wanderings, as Krishna says. The Paramatma is also active.
Thank you.
Okay, Hare Krishna. All right, thank you very much. Yeah, Janitai Prabhu. One.
I had a question, Maharaj, but also one of our viewers online sent me a message with a question. Firstly, thanks you for the class. And he says that you mentioned about Pondraka. So what was the destination of Pondraka? And then part two is that we see that there are many Pondraka-like personalities in the world at present. And how should devotees deal with those type of personalities?
Whoever Krishna kills personally is delivered. Can we close the door then perhaps?
I think you'd have to close the building. they're drilling next door.
The question is that what was the destination of Pondraka, the king who was killed by Krishna? It was mentioned in the course of the lecture. And what is the destination of other people who similarly act like Pondraka? Yeah?
Second part, not exactly, Maharaji, was how should devotees interact and deal with persons who have a Pondraka-like mentality?
Oh, I see. Okay. So because Pondraka was personally killed by Krishna, definitely Pondraka was delivered. That's one of the important qualities of Krishna. Hatari gatidayakaha. In the Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu it is said, one of the five qualities that Lord Narayan has, which even Shiva doesn't have, is that he delivers his enemies. So Pondraka was delivered, but other people who are inimical to the Lord, they go to the lower planets. That's in the Bhagavad Gita. Unless they are so great in their demoniac natures that Krishna personally comes and kills them, then they are delivered. It is not easy to be tremendously great asuras. It's easier to become a pure devotee. So better we should just go on the path of devotion and perfect our lives. So therefore those who try to imitate Pondraka, they are not headed for pleasant destinations. So how do we as devotees interact with those who are of this mentality? It's better to avoid them if they're very envious. This is also the instructions of the Srimad Bhagavatam. Prema Maitri Kripopeksha. So these four things we have towards Ishvaratad Adhineshu, Balishu, Dvishatsucha, the four categories of people. There's Ishvara, that's the Supreme Lord. Tad Adhineshu, those who are surrendered to him, that is the devotees, that's the second category. Balishu, those who are innocent. Dvishatsu, those who are envious. So these four categories. How should we deal with these four categories? Ishvara, that is Krishna, is prema. So we should have a very loving relationship with Krishna. Then with the devotees, maitri, a very warm friendship with the devotees. What about the balishu, the innocent? Kripa, we should be very compassionate and kind to them. Dvishatsu, those who are envious, how should we interact? We should ignore them. Upeksha, we should be indifferent to them and avoid them. So it's better to keep away from those who are very envious. But if somebody is ignorant but innocent and is not, or rather is willing to hear something about Krishna, are willing to receive your prasadam and so on, yes, we should go up and try our best to induce that person to take to Krishna consciousness. Okay? Okay, thank you very much. Srila Prabhupada ki jai, Sri Sri Radha Landanishwar ki jai, Sri Sri Jagannath Baladev Subhadra Mai ki jai, Sri Sri Gaur Nitai ki jai, Gaur Premanande. Hare Krishna.
Krishna. So we've been very blessed and fortunate to have Maharaj's association for the last 3 days. We'd like to express our gratitude and appreciation to you, Maharaj, for coming and giving us your association. And also would like to encourage you to please come back and give us more of your association when you have time. So please let us express our gratitude and appreciation by chanting very loudly three Hari Bols.
Hari Bol! Hari Bol!
So in this Bhakti Rasamrita Maharaj Ki Jai. So for the pleasure of their lordships, we have some Sankirtan scores from yesterday. In Radha's boutique, we distributed 9 books for 325 Lakshmi points. And in Govinda's restaurant, we distributed prasadam to at least 308 customers for a total of 2,796 Lakshmi points. Transcendental prasadam distribution, ki jai. And on book distribution yesterday, 2 scores reported, starting with Madhuri Gaurangi Mataji, collected 31 Lakshmi, distributed 5 Mahabig for 10 book points. And Baba Bhakti's Counselee Group, 40 Lakshmi, 8 Mahabig for 16 book points. Total of 2 scores, 71 Lakshmi, 13 Mahabig books for 26 book points. Srila Prabhupada's Transcendental Book Distribution, Ki Jai. And there is a plan is to have Sankirtan meeting this morning with devotees who do book distribution. We have His Grace Radha Ramanpuru, who will be with us again this morning. And that will be in the seminar room at 10 a.m. So devotees who are doing book distribution would like to attend, you can please come for that program. Okay, so now we'll offer our prayer to their lordships. To empower us to distribute Srila Prabhupada's books. Dear Shri Shri Radha Landanishwara, Jagannath Baladev and Subhadra, Shri Shri Gaurani Thai, and Giri Govardhan, we offer our most respectful obeisances unto you. With a mood of deep gratitude and appreciation, we request your causeless mercy upon us. For your pleasure, we are endeavoring to distribute the books of your pure devotee Srila Prabhupada to the fallen conditioned souls in London. Please enable us to cooperate together in a mood of selfless service in order to maintain and increase our efforts. Please send more devotees to assist us in bringing many new souls to your lotus feet. We, your surrendered servants, humbly beg. Jai Srila Prabhupada's Transcendental Book Distribution, Ki Jai, Srila Prabhupada, Ki Jai. So we just need volunteers this morning to serve breakfast prasadam on the ladies' side. Anyone who can volunteer? Okay. And volunteers on the men's side for serving breakfast prasadam this morning. Any volunteers for that service? Okay. And anyone who can help clean up the temple room after breakfast? One. Anyone else who can help with that? Need maybe one more volunteer? Okay, I have to conscript someone later. Okay, thank you very much. If everyone can please help to bring the prasadam up so that we can serve out. Solan is Bhakti Rasamrita Maharaj Ki Jai. Hare Krishna.
Thank you. Thank you. Alles klar. Because we don't know what to do. And can you find somebody who knows, please? Can you find, put this all back, please? Because we don't know what to do. We need to have proper equipment, and we can't use the wrong things. Krishna won't be pleased.